fermentation options numbered tray. That's three for you English speakers. Let's name this one, the container counts. And so does the cap. What's that you asked? The cap? Yes. We'll cap off this mini lecture talking about what a cap is. Put it in perspective for you. This is the third in our winemaker options series. Those series of things that the winemaker has a decision in, that plays a hand in, that can radically affect the flavors and aromas of the finished wine. We started with number one, the maceration and must manipulation that the winemaker does. Two, the beastly yeastly choices for primary fermentation that the winemaker chooses. And now three, what type of vessel will the winemaker choose to ferment their wine in? Really? The vessel? Boy, are you going to give us a whole lecture on a container? Yeah, it actually is radically important. Why would that be? Well, since we've been dealing with a liquid in our winemaking processes, at least for most of this, and certainly for the rest of these processes, liquid. And we're always going to have to employ a vessel or container to hold that liquid so it doesn't spill out all over the place and we lose our wine. We need to contain our juice, or our must, at all times during all processes, during the juice extraction, during must manipulation, during the primary fermentation, during a possible secondary fermentation, even during maturation, that is the aging of the wines and barrels. All of these things are containers. And different container types are made of different materials. And different materials have different properties. And different properties can affect the beverage in very different ways during any or all of the processes I just named. So what container the winemaker chooses to employ at different parts of the process is an integral part of the finished style of the wine that you have at the end of the game. It's actually way more important than you think of. Now, just to put it in a perspective here of some brief vessel history. Humans have been trying for 10,000 years to figure out better and better ways to hold stuff, and to hold liquids in particular. And they've gone from open pits to crevices in rock to earthenware crocks and earthenware pots and even earthenware huge underground vessels. Remember back when I was did that little thing on orange wine? I showed you a picture, actually, of something called a cuvery, I think. And it's like a 6-foot tall earthenware pot that they buried underground and packed full of white grape must, and then sealed off the top and buried it so that it was temperature controlled. Yeah. And once they figured out how to fire earthenware products, they had clay and finished fired clay that's way less porous and even better at holding stuff. So they have clay jars to clay amphora, those pointy kind of vase looking things, which were employed for fermentation, but also aging and transport of wine for centuries during the ancient world. And then some smart folks figured out how to design a barrel out of wood. And once they got that, then they started making bigger barrels out of wood. Then they made gigantic barrel tanks out of wood. And in today's world, awesome technologies have spawned things like stainless steel tanks. And even plastic buckets and plastic bins. Oh, glass. I forgot glass. Glass jars and carboys of all shapes and sizes have been employed to hold in liquids. But also when we're talking about fermentation and wine, hold in liquids and exclude air. People for 10,000 years have kind of known these are the two things we want this device to do, and we've continued to tweak them century after century to do it better. Now, in the modern world, we're looking pretty much just at the latter containers. Yes, 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 some people still use earthenware underground crocks in Georgia and clay amphora in Greece. But that's the fringe, that's not the standard. We're looking at the things like the plastics and the glasses. And when you think about food grade plastic buckets and glass carboys, those are really employed by home brewers. And when I say home brewer, I mean people that brew beer at home, people that brew wine at home, ferment wine at home. And any home brewer would be well versed with, you know, a 5 gallon, a 6 gallon plastic bucket, or a 5 gallon, 6 gallon, 7 gallon glass carboy or demijohn. These are standard operating procedure for extremely small scale, non-commercial production. You're making stuff in your home. And they work fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. Easy to clean. You can put a little valve on them to exclude air. I just called it airlock to exclude air. They work great. But we're talking here about commercial, about big boy brewing and fermenting. And that's no diss in my home brewing brothers and sisters who are keeping the world afloat with fantastic home brews, all right? But we're talking commercial. Commercial winery, when they go to start fermenting large amounts of grapes, large amounts of juice, they generally are going to use one of two vessels. Very large wooden fermentation tanks, or very large stainless steel fermentation tanks. And yes, I know probably already in your head you're saying, oh, wooden fermentation tanks, you mean a barrel. Not so much. Barrels are used in a latter part of all this for aging, okay? And they integrate all these flavors and all this other stuff. We're talking about primary fermentation here. For this lecture, we're talking about what big old thing do you have all your juice in that's, while it's turning into alcohol. So, yes, wineries use barrels mostly for aging. And yes, wooden fermentation vessels come in all shapes and sizes. Regular ones, huge ones. And stainless steel tanks come in all shapes and sizes. Super gigantic ones, big as a grain silo, and even way smaller ones that serve as holding tanks. It's mostly, the point here is, mostly what I'm talking about, it's a wood versus stainless steel world in modern wine. So let's focus our attentions on those. Just take them one at a time and point out their attributes and what they bring to a finished wine. We'll start with wood. Yeah, wood is good. And when I say a wood fermentation vessel, I mean just that. It's made out of wood. Yes, you think of a standard barrel, right? It's pieces of wood put together, steel hoops holding it together. And yes, you can use a standard barrel for a primary fermentation, but that's a pretty small batch, okay? And if you have, you know, 10,000 gallons of juice, you are not doing your primary fermentation in standard wine barrel shaped stuff and size stuff. It's just not practical. Wine barrels are expensive. They can only be used so many times. So you don't use them for your primary fermentation. You can. Some small scale producers do. Okay. But again, we're talking the bulk of wine produced on planet Earth. We're talking about very large wooden barrels, very large wooden fermentation vessels. Call them a vat or a cask if it helps you differentiate between the types. And I'll try to do that myself as a standard. If I say barrel, I'm talking about a wooden barrel that's used for aging, maturation later, okay? If I say a wooden vat or cask, I'm talking about a big old honking sucker that they're doing a primary fermentation in. And these things can, again, be the size of a Volkswagen car or the size of the room you're sitting in. They could be the size of the house you're in. They could be the size of the apartment complex you're in. These things can get gigantic. And even a standard large wooden fermentation vessel is big enough to have a party in. In fact, people get literally into them to clean them out with a big old snow shovel to clean out the rest of the great must and stuff at the end of this process. So, yeah, these things are big and they hold a lot. Now, let me put it in context for you. Maybe I shouldn't keep dancing around this and give you some hard numbers, not because I dislike trivia, because I don't, but to give you a sense of scale. A standard wooden barrel for maturation and aging holds 225 liters of liquid. Liquid gold we call wine. 225 liters, that's about 60 gallons. Think about 60 gallons of milk at the shelf there at Kroger, all right? So 225 liters of a standard wooden barrel is 300 standard 750 milliliter bottles. You do the math in metric, okay? 300 bottles per wooden wine barrel, okay? 225 liters. The fermentation devices I'm talking about hold not 225 liters, they hold 1,000 liters. Or 5,000 liters, or 10,000 liters of wine at a time. that's like 300 to 1,000 to 3,000 gallons at a time, and in some cases even bigger than that. In fact, the largest wooden fermentation vessel on planet Earth, I think it still has the record, is the Heidelberg Tun. I'll give you one guess where it's located at, and your guess is Germany. The Heidelberg Tun, I think it's several hundred years old, holds 219,000 liters of wine. That's 58,000 U.S. gallons of wine. And, you know, I don't think it's seen any action since before the big war, and that'd be World War One. These things are largely tourist attractions now, and I think the Heidelberg Tun is a dance hall. It's that big. However, having said that, it's not the only one, and there are really super large wooden vats across Europe that you should go check out. And some of them are still functional, and they say that, you know, things ferment differently because of the scale, because there's so much liquid in there that it actually chemically does things differently than if you do it in a small batch. But now we're getting off into trivia stuff, okay? Here's the points I also want you to understand about wooden fermentation vessels. They're reusable. So wine barrels, maybe you've already learned this at a different part of the course, they're typically used 2 or 3, 4 times tops, and then they're played out. Because you want to get flavors from the oak, and you only get those flavors so many times before you literally have leached out the flavors. So with wine barrels, 3, 4, maybe 5 times, I guess, usually 3. And you throw them away and get a new one. The fermentation devices I'm talking about are super gigantic, okay? And they're reused. They may last 30, 40, 50, 60 years if the vessel is still in good shape. And that's important to understand because you may pick up with my wine barrel comparison, if you use these big barrels for 30 years, they're already leached out. They've been played out for decades. They're not imparting any of the rich, aggressive flavors of a new oak barrel. That's important to note and put a star on it if you don't understand why it's important. We use oak barrels specifically for flavors. We use wooden fermentation vessels for different reasons, and it ain't flavor. Okay, it's not oak flavor that gets imparted. That's why it's important. So why would you use wood at all then? Well, because wood is wood. Wood is good, and wood's natural, and it's fibrous, and it's porous. Ah, same reason we use them for maturation, but wood is porous even in these gigantic tanks, which means it does allow for a bit of integration of oxygen. Just a bit. Just a bit. Now, I know you're shaking your head going, wah, wah, wah. You have said a million times oxygen is super bad for the grape juice. Oxygen is super bad to get into the fermentation. Oxygen is what makes wine go bad even in a bottle 20 years later. True, but it is too much of a generalization to say that you want to exclude all oxygen at all times. No, it's bad in big amounts because you know why. Too much oxygen gets in there, then acetobacteria go to work and they eat all of your alcohol and turn into vinegar. But that's if it's a lot of oxygen. They need a lot of oxygen to survive and thrive and do their thing. If you just put a little bit of oxygen, and porous wood allows for that, in the primary fermentation vessel made of wood, a little bit of oxygen gets in there. It actually helps make the wine fuller, a little richer, a little rounder. It starts to shave off the rough ends of the wine, even as it's being made into wine. It will help add a little bit more body. It's more of a tactile thing. It has better mouthfeel. But let me restress, but it does not impart any new oak flavors. Okay, so it's more of a slow, very little bit of integration of oxygen that wood allows, that stainless steel doesn't, that beefs up and rounds out certain wines. Mostly in reds, but you could ferment your white wine in a wooden fermentation vessel, and it will pick up some of the richness of the mouthfeel and the roundness, but it will also probably add a little bit of color, because oxygen will allow for, I won't call it browning, but during the oxygen integration into a white wine, during fermentation, it's going to add a little bit of color. And actually, the wood itself may add just a bit of color. So we're talking just hints more of richness and more roundness of a white wine that was fermented in a wooden vessel, okay? Now, many, although not all, red wines are fermented in wood. And I actually don't know the numbers. I'm just going to be blunt with you. You know me. I'm always honest. I kind of want to say, oh, well, all red wines are fermented in wood. I don't think that's the case. I'm going to say many. It's definitely not all. Many red wines are primary fermented in wooden casks. Some whites are. And again, what whites? Yeah, some that are going to end up being fuller and richer-bodied white wines. However, a whole lot of wines are done in something else entirely that's not wood. And now I'm on real stable ground with these explanations, right? And these quantifiers. Many wines are not primarily fermented in a wooden vat. Most wines, probably on planet Earth at this point in the game, are fermented in stainless steel. Hello, that's the other option that we're shifting to now. Stainless steel is really the kind of industry standard. It is everywhere. Even a small to medium-scaled winery would have 1, 2, or 20 stainless steel tanks, and again, of varying size. I know that since wine has become so popular in the United States, a lot of winemakers have bought their stainless steel tanks from old dairy farms.
Yeah.
Because stainless steel is a great container. So it used to be, I'm sure it is still used in the milk industry, but there's less of the milk industry, more of the wine industry now. So stainless steel is awesome, and you can get these holding tanks just to hold your juice before you ferment. You can use stainless steel to ferment your juice. You can use stainless steel to clarify your juice later. You can use stainless steel to let your wine chill out with. And some of these things are, again, as big as the room you're in, some as big as the apartment complex you're in. I've been in wineries, huge-scale production wineries in Italy. Woo! In Tuscany, this one, I think it's Antinori. My gosh! These stainless steel tanks were as big as a grain silo. I swear those things were 40 or 50 or 60 feet high. It was just, and there was a row of them. It was mind-boggling. Having said that, you know, those wood ones are pretty big too, but stainless steel is super big, and it's super awesome. It's a super awesome material. Why would so many winemakers use it? It has a very long shelf life. Those wooden containers I was telling you about, the big ones, I mean, some of them are so big, it takes craftsmanship to do that. They're so big, they actually have to be assembled on site. I was in Croatia at a small scale winery, and the folks there, they were awesome. But they were actually doing primary fermentation in wooden fermentation vessels. But they weren't gigantic, but they were like head high. They were like 6 foot high. Came up right to my head, and they were like 3-4 foot wide and like 6 or 7 foot deep. This was big. This was, again, the size of a Volkswagen Beetle. And there was like 30 of these things in a basement. And then I realized there's only a stairwell coming down here that just I barely fit through. How did you guys get these casks down here? They're like, oh, you build them on site. And that's the way the huge ones are, even in modern wineries. If you see a big old honking wooden fermentation vessel, there's been a team of people that came and constructed that thing. Now, shift back to stainless steel. What's that got to do with stainless steel? Well, stainless steel is easier. It's a machinable thing. You can build them probably a lot cheaper. You can customize them very easily. And that's just the beginnings of why they're so awesome. They're super easy to sanitize. That's huge. Wood, again, because it's porous, and we like that about wood, but because it's porous, you know, microbes can get in there, critters can get in there, so they're harder to clean. Stainless steel is awesomely smooth. It's one of the reasons why it's used in kitchen-grade stuff in every restaurant you've been in. It's easy to clean. Microbes can't permeate it very easily. So super easy to sanitize, super easy to get in and out of. They have a very long shelf life. I said wooden might go 20, 30, 40, 60 years. I would assume stainless steel tanks have an indefinite lifespan unless they physically break. If somebody punches a hole in them. So easy to sanitize, very reusable, long shelf life. But the two most important features of stainless steel are, one, they're neutral. What? What are they, Switzerland? Who cares if they're neutral? It's actually quite important for winemaking, especially with today's wine styles. And what I mean by this is stainless steel imparts zero into the juice and or the must and or the finished wine. That's why they're great as holding tanks. They will not affect any flavors or any aromas at all, zero, none. So you're getting, say, the best of the best of the juice flavors that you want as a winemaker. If you put them in wood, well, you're going to add some other thing. If you keep it in stainless steel, you know what you're working with all the time, and you can manipulate and pull out the things you want. And they're going to stay there because the stainless steel ain't going to mess with it. Does that make sense? They're neutral. They impart zero input to the beverage. The second major awesome, super awesome reason that stainless steel has taken over the wine world is that you can put a refrigerator jacket around them. What? What's that got to do with anything? Yeah, basically, you just kind of put a refrigerated cold jacket all around the tank, no matter how big or small the tank is. What's that mean? It means you can temperature control the fermentation. Bam! That is super important. And important enough to discuss for our whole class, not just this small element of wine production. Because refrigeration means you have full temperature control over the primary fermentation, which means you can do things you couldn't do before. And refrigeration itself is kind of new. I know in a human lifespan, we're like, what? That was a long time ago. Yeah, refrigeration's been around for a whopping like 120 years. That's like squat in the big picture of things. Commercially adopted refrigeration, probably not till the 1920s, 1930s. Commercial use of these refrigerated stainless steel tanks in the wine industry, the 1950s, the 1960s. So what's the history lesson got to do with how the wine turns out or the wine at all? Well, just hold on to that for a second, because there are whole new styles of wine on planet Earth because of this one particular innovation in stainless steel. And since we're here at still kind of at the beginning of the winemaking process, because we're chatting about primary fermentation, we'll get to secondary later, but we're still with primary. It's here at the selection of the vessel is where more and more differences start to emerge between white wine production and red wine production. And emerge for good reason, because whatever vessel you put that juice in is going to radically affect the style that it ends up in, especially with whites. Especially with whites. Did I say especially with whites? How? Back to that temperature control now. Temperature control is the key. Because red wines, I'm just going to call it like a spade, I think, here. They can ferment hot. They can go hot. Red wines can ferment 20 to 30 degrees Celsius. They're fine with that. That's cool. We can hang out. And that's about 70 to 85 degrees Fahrenheit. Now, again, you already know this from last lecture, but different yeast have different heat tolerances and different alcohol tolerances and all that stuff. And I'm just picking a kind of medium average range. Red wines can ferment at 20 to 30 degrees Celsius. No big deal. They've been doing it for centuries. White wines are usually fermented a bit colder, if not a lot colder. And let's pick some numbers. Maybe an average white wine production in today's modern world is fermented at 7 to 15 degrees Celsius, which is about 45 to 60 degrees Fahrenheit. Yeah, now you're starting to talk about your refrigerator. But you know what? You could ferment those white wines at a higher temperature. And you could ferment them at a lower temperature. And in fact, some people are experimenting around with, oh, let's take it down to like 5 degrees. Let's see what happens. But, you know, remember, if you freeze it, then the yeast stop working, so your fermentation stops. And if you get it too hot, fermentation stops. So it depends on, you're making white wine or red wine. They're now fermented at very specific temperature zones to get the most out of the fermentation to make the wine that you want. What is it about chilling white wine that's desirable? How come you just don't let them ferment at room temperature? Because that's essentially what reds are doing. It's ferment at room temperature. We don't care. Well, when you ferment at a cooler temperature, especially with whites. You're maintaining the delicate, clean, fruity, floral, crisp, fresh, even spritzy flavor descriptions and components. Why? Because if you allow, because white wines are delicate, they have these compounds in them. The flavor and aroma compounds are what we call very volatile, which means they'll dissipate fast. If you raise the temperature too hot, you'll essentially tear them apart molecularly, and you'll lose those flavors. Again, reds are used to it. We don't care. Reds are hardier. Red wines are hardier, and red compounds and flavors are hardier. They're okay. Whites are delicate, and they're easy to destroy. And that is why these styles of wine that we are quite used to and that are available to us in today's modern wine world are actually kind of new. They're at least more novel than they've ever been in history. Because think about it historically. Before refrigeration, where do grapes grow really well? Historically, where do you consider, grape growing regions? Hotter climates. Especially today's California, Australia, but, you know, southern Italy, southern Spain, southern Greece. Okay, so it's hot. When do you harvest the grapes? Oh, yeah, late summer, fall, and it's hot. At least warm or hot. What is a byproduct of fermentation itself? Heat! Is it all falling into place now? So, throughout almost all human history up to 120 years ago, when you were trying to make white wine, you were making something, but it wouldn't taste nothing like the white wines that we drink in today's world. It was physically impossible to make a light, fruity, floral Chardonnay 5,000 years ago. It just was impossible. When I say the word impossible, somebody will think of some clever way to transport juice across the Alps to Germany and ferment it there. But again, pre-refrigeration, the juice will be spoiling pretty fast too. So chilling your white wine during the primary fermentation does a whole bunch of really great things. For starters, it lessens the activity of other unwanted microbes, that is the other yeast and other bacteria that, again, are naturally happening. If you're working at a lower temperature, then all processes slow down, including the bad ones you don't want. Two, cooling down your white wine during primary fermentation limits the loss of those volatile aromatic components that we want to keep in the wine till they finish. Till they put them in a bottle, till we put them in our glass, okay? Again, the fermentation itself gets so hot, it would naturally burn up a lot of those delicate aromatics if you just let it go. Three, you have greater alcohol yield because of this slower, cooler fermentation process. Primarily, I think, because you have less alcohol loss due to evaporation. So you're in this enclosed tank, it's chilled, it's slower. You're getting a basic better chemical reaction. You're getting more, all right? You're teasing more alcohol out of the glucose. It just works better that way. And you're dampening down any loss to heat, evaporation loss to heat, okay? Alcohol evaporation loss due to heat. So on top of that, longer, slower, cooler ferments make for more intense bouquets, especially the nose. Okay, the bouquet, what you get, a lot of those, again, flavors and smells are all those aromatized little molecules hanging out above the wine, and you get more of them and more intense ones with a slower, cooler ferment. And you typically would say, and this is now a generalization, finer overall quality of your white wine. Okay, that makes sense. So the advent of temperature-controlled stainless steel tanks have just truly revolutionized, especially the white wine industry. And they have helped create this whole slew of styles of wine. But it's also opened up and allowed wines to be created much more easily and practically in areas that would have otherwise been challenging or unsuitable for wine production. I'm bringing it back to geography class now. What do you mean the innovation, a technological innovation of stainless steel somehow affected wine geography on the planet? Yes. You think about super hot climates, especially super hot climates during the harvest season. California, South Africa, Australia, southern Greece, southern Italy, southern Spain. I mean, even old world places like southern Spain. Yes, they've been making white wines for a long time, but they never made white wines like this until the last 120 years, okay? So places like California, they might, without refrigeration, they might be making still some banging great red wines, but California would not be known as a major Chardonnay producer on planet Earth without refrigeration, okay? Australia, you wouldn't be getting great Viogniers out of Australia were it not for refrigeration. It's too hot, and the ferment would be too hot, and you'd lose all of the things that we associate that we like with those light, delicate, crisp, floral, fruity, zesty wines, okay? Switch it back to reds. We don't care. With reds, we're not so worried. We're not as concerned with the temperature. We're not as concerned to control the temperature of the fermentation. You can. Again, put your red wine in a wooden or a stainless steel tank that has been fitted with a refrigerator jacket. I'm assuming you could put them on a wooden tank too. You can. I don't think you mostly do though. Warm to hot ferments are fine, but again, even with red wines, not too hot. You don't want your fermentation to go too hot because it gets stuck. Remember that term, right? So you can't blast the yeast, let them get too out of control. You can allow it to get hot, but not too hot. So you can do your red wine primary fermentation stainless steel if you want. You can control the temperature if you want. It's not quite as important in the finished wine. So many or most red wines are done in wood because we prefer the roundness that we get with that introduction of that little bit of oxygen mix in the process. However, with red wines, remember, we're dealing with must, not juice. Man, am I bringing in another term to you? Yes, I am. I'm getting ready to bring you another winemaking term. This stuff is must that we're fermenting to make red wine. Meaning it's the slurry, right? It's the juice and the skins and maybe the stalks and all this other junk and the seeds. What's that got to do with anything? Well, because when we're doing our primary fermentation in wood or in stainless steel with our red wine, we're going to have to deal with the cap. Oh, no. Bam. Here we go. Putting the hat back on. We have to do something called punch down the cap. Okay, well, let's define the cap first, and then why are we going to punch it? Why we got to be so mean to the cap? The cap is formed through natural fermentation process in red wine, in red wine must, because as the fermentation is starting, and it's bubbling and frothing, and it's all this microbiological activity with the yeast, and heat's going out of it, and CO2's bubbling up out of it, it is naturally taking all of these sugars out of the grapes. The yeast are eating them, right? And therefore making the grape skins and the seeds lighter. As they eat the sugar, that big chunk of grape becomes lighter because you're taking all the sugar out of it. And eventually it starts to float up through the action of all the bubbling CO2 and all this stuff. And so at the top of your vat, no matter what the vat or vessel is, you will have a collection of this mass of grape skins and seeds and stems and any other junk that's in there that's floated up. Now, you might think in your head, oh, well, it's like bubbling on the top. It's just a little bit of it. No, we're talking about a mat of it that can be several inches to, I guess, a foot thick, depending upon how big your fermentation vessel is. And this stuff masses together. And again, it's almost like it's being cooked because of the heat that's being kicked off the fermentation. So it really gets matted together and even dried out, and it kind of feels like leather. It's super cool. So it's leathery to the touch, and it becomes matted and tough, and it can actually turn into a cake. Now, again, historically, that's not a bad thing because, you know, 1,000 years ago, 2,000 years ago, under less controlled conditions, if you have your big open vat of red wine fermenting, this cap would form, and it becomes a natural barrier that won't allow oxygen to penetrate back through. I mean, it's great. So the wine just sits underneath the cap and just chugs away. The fermentation's chugging away and pushing up CO2 and all is well. However, what it's doing simultaneously that we don't like so much in the modern wine world is that it's collecting all the skins up in one place. It's smashing them all together so they're not interacting with the juice anymore. They're not doing that maceration gig anymore. And if we're trying to get the most extract out of those grape skins in terms of colors and tannins, then we want them in the liquid. We don't want them all at the top because there's nothing in the liquid. So now we get to the boom, the punching of the cap. We gotta punch down the cap, and it's actually a French term, as so many things are, called pigéage. It looks like pigéage. I like pigéage better, but pigéage is a term that translates to punching down the cap, and that means physically getting up there and not really with your fist, but boom, punching through this matted, leathery bundle of skins and breaking them up and smashing them back down into the liquid. You can do it with a tool, with a shovel. They make all sorts of different implements now to smash stuff up and crush it up, and you'll see pictures of winemakers standing over the vats, you know, over top of them, smashing the stuff down and plunging it in. It makes a super cool sound, by the way. It's like flushing a gigantic toilet. When you take one of these plungers and pretend like you're plunging a toilet, literally, but you're plunging through the cap. When you push down into it, it sounds like a giant toilet being flushed. It goes. As it's integrated back in and CO2 rushes out. It's super cool. So punching down the cap, pigéage, is this process of smashing back apart the layer or the cap to get it back down into and interacting and macerating further with the rest of the juice. So how do you do it? Well, you can do it by hand, like I said. Punch it with your fist, but with a shovel or a stick or some implement. You can do it by feet. And I said when we were talking about pressing during the grape pressing that, yeah, there's this tradition that people used to stomp with their feet on the grapes and get the stuff out, and they still do it in the port region of Portugal. That's true. But by and large, nobody does it anymore. When it comes to punching down the cap, yeah, actually, people still do it by foot in places. And again, it's because these, especially older, fermentation vessels are so huge that they physically would get up, a team of two or three or four guys would get up, and you can stand, walk out in a big enough vat, walk out onto the cap, and then like hold on to monkey bars and literally just start smashing and kicking down into it to physically by foot get the stuff back in down in there. And you see pictures of these French guys, these hairy French guys, and you know they don't use deodorant, who are in there like half naked smashing stuff back in down into your wine. And just so you know, that's what gives it a little ho, 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 French flavor in your French wine. It's part of it. It's part of it, baby. But yes, some of that still happens. And in fact, some people die. You will hear sporadic stories once or twice a decade about some French people that died during pigéage, during punching down the cap. Now, why would that be? Did they just drown? They fell through the cap. Oh! And drowned in wine. Not a bad way to go. No, actually, it's from asphyxiation, because as you start punching down that cap, and especially if you're by yourself or it's just a couple of you, and you punch down the cap, when you penetrate the cap, you're getting CO2, massive amounts of CO2 released, depending on how big the vat is. So people literally punch through, get overwhelmed, asphyxiated with CO2, pass out, and then drown in a vat of wine. Ugh, not such a good way. I'll take the straight drowning. Anyway, by hand in smaller tanks, by feet in bigger tanks, by machine in most tanks. Just so you know, yes, technology keeps pushing forward and we can do these things better. So they even have certain fermentation tanks that have basically like a beater inside of it that you can turn on and it will start to punch, smash through and crush up and reintegrate the cap back into it. There's also pump over. I think pump overs are more common than even the mixer puncher. And that is that, you know, you have a big tank, an enclosed tank that's pushing off CO2, so you can enclose it and basically charge the tank and use the pressure from the gas to pump the liquid from the bottom of the tank and pump it up and sprinkle it back over the cap. So that's called a pump over. don't cost you nothing, right? You just got to set it up. Or you could physically, I guess, get a fire hose and pump from the bottom of the tank with an electric pump and then spray it back over the top. So there's lots of different ways to keep the cap wet, keep it integrated, continue maceration, continue extraction. And the reason I'm telling you this in some detail now is, yes, I'm a geek, but it's also because this has really become kind of a fine art and is a way more important component of winemaking than even I thought a few years back. And so we had an awesome Virginia winemaker, Emily Pelton from Veritas, came and talked to the class a few years back, and she's the head winemaker. And she had like four or five slides just on punching down the cap. And I was like, what is she talking about this for so long? And she was going into detail of, oh, well, and in the fourth day of primary fermentation, we'll punch down the cap at 2 a.m. And then on the seventh day, we'll punch it down three times that day. And then on day 10, I was like, what? I had to ask her afterwards over a glass of wine, of course. I'm like, you talked a lot about punching down the cap. And she said, oh, no, it's super important. I mean, they're doing all sorts of studies now that you're getting different types of extractions at different times that are now desirable to the winemaker. So, again, these are winemaker options, and punching down the cap is a whole nother field of options that the winemaker can utilize to affect their finished product. They can choose to not punch down at all and have less extractions, or punch down at a certain time schedule that gets certain things in certain percentages they want. It's super cool. I know, it's just super geeky, but now you know about punching down the cap and why your French wine tastes a little funky. In summary, stainless steel versus wood with primary fermentation. Stainless steel, super awesome. Temperature controlled, slower primary ferment, maintains those delicate aromas and flavor compounds in a cooler environment, allows for 0% integration of oxygen, though, so you won't get that rounding. Is a neutral container that adds no additional flavor components to the wine, and all the other benefits I listed that have also helped create a whole new class of wines in today's modern wine market. Wood, the alternative, not so temperature controlled, although it could be fitted to be temperature controlled. So you have a warmer or hotter, more volatile ferment. Vessel is slightly porous, so it's going to allow a little bit of oxygen interaction, which adds that richness and body a little bit, and typically used for red grape must that then forms that cap that you need to deal with to increase colors and tannin extractions during this extended combination maceration and primary fermentation process. Are all these terms now starting to make more sense to you since you've listened to me rant on about them for hours? Now, whatever type of wine you're making, red or white, and whichever type of vessel you're using for your primary fermentation, you're going to be wrapping up this primary fermentation and moving this proto wine to some other potential processes that are going to add some other potential flavors. And those are going to be picked up in something we're going to call secondary fermentation techniques that we'll tackle in another lecture. But be it primary or secondary in the fermentation, or some airy in between, there is a particular wooden vessel. I can't let the wood vessels go. There's a particular wooden vessel that plays such a huge role in this wine game, as much if not more than stainless steel, that I actually just want to take a break from the fermentation gig to roll out the barrel so that we'll have a barrel of fun learning about it, right? Let's move to barrels next. Barrel.